Hello and welcome to my session about Azure PureView. Ciao e benvenuti a mia sessione su Azure PureView. My name is Erwin de Kreuk and I'm working as a lead data and AI for InSpark, a Microsoft partner in the Netherlands. 2 seconds, yeah. As InSpark, we help organizations accelerating their digital transformation with impactful Microsoft solutions and expertise. And today couldn't be happening without all the proud sponsors below on the screen you can see. So if you have some time, give them a shout out. Today, I'm going to talk about Azure PureView. And Azure PureView is a unified data governance, which is a new service within Microsoft. During this session, I will explain what Azure PureView is, the position of Azure PureView within your data estate, and how it works with some practical examples. And if you have questions, please put them in the chat and I will try to answer them. If you look to the history of Azure PureView, it started all like about 2 years ago with Azure Data Catalog Gen 1. In June 2019, Microsoft did an acquisition on Blue Talon, a company which was specialized in data governance products. Then they did a transition to Data Catalog Gen 2. Still, a lot of people were not happy. And then I think last year in January or December 2019, we started with some new private previews, which finally resulted last year in December with the announcement of Azure PureView during the data estate journey with Satya Nadella. With Azure PureView, Microsoft has now its own cloud native service for data governance and data lineage. And I'm really curious and I hope you too, what the future will bring and what the position of Azure PureView will be compared, for example, to Collibra, Informatica, Amazon Glue Data Catalog, or other data governance products. So back to Azure PureView. If you look to Azure PureView, it's data governance. As we all know, data governance is becoming more and more increasingly interdisciplinary. So in your company, mostly, a lot of companies or larger companies, they have a chief data officer, a CDO. And a CDO is a corporate officer who is responsible for the enterprise-wide governance and utilization of information as an asset via data processing, analysis, data mining, and information training and other means. And he will be the one of, or the one of the users who want to use Azure PureView and to get some answers. And he wants to have some answers about what kind of data do I have, where is the data coming from, or what is the originate, and can I trust my data? But on the other side, he wants to know what is the compliancy. Compliancy is getting more and more important with all these required regulations from the local governments or industries. For example, the ISO certifications or the NIN certifications. And besides these questions, the CDO also wants to have some answers on, okay, what is the risk if I do expose my data? Is the use of my data, is it compliant? And how can I control the access and the use of my data? And of course, what I already mentioned, the required regulations. To implement a successful data governance, we have defined four elements. You need to have control on your on how your data landscape is growing. Data is getting more and more important in a lot of companies. But with the come of that so much data, you also will see that new silos on every laptops are coming in. Because if you look to a data silo is a collection of data held by one group, and that's not easily or fully accessible for other groups. So if I have a data silo for HR, that doesn't mean that my finance department or my administration department or even other departments can work with the same data silo. So how can we make sure that these individual collections or often overlapping but not inconsistent data are not in that separate silos? You want to increase the flexibility and agility of your data. And you want to make sure you comply with all these regular of industry regulations and the local government regulations, what I just mentioned before. And hopefully Azure PureView can help you with these elements. If you look to Azure PureView, it consists of a couple of different layers. The first layer we have is a data map, where we can automate and manage our metadata at scale. The second one is a data catalog. The data catalog we are going to use to discover and to search for our data. And the last one is data insights, to get a bird overview of what is happening with our data. How many scans did we did? How many kind of different data types do we, or you know, not data types, but file types do we have in the system? What kind of data sources do we have? What kind of data lakes do we have? And that's kind of what are we going to see within our data insights. And the complete things, the data map, the data catalog, and the data insights, that's what is going to be Azure Purview. In the future, privacy, quality, and master data management will follow as well. Azure Purview, what I already mentioned, unified data governance. There are four pillars which helps you to maximize the business value of your organization. The first one is data governance. I already mentioned a little bit. You need to set the foundation for an effective data governance. You need to create the business value for your business users. And of course, the insights that I already explained should not be missing. If you look to the first topic or the first pillar, I want to have a product where it's cloud native. It should be managed. It should be serverless. And I want to have it as a platform as a service. I don't want to do any maintenance on it. And I want to have a product which can eliminate manual ad hoc and homegrown solutions. So these different silos, which I just mentioned. The second one, how can we set the foundation for an effective data governance? How can we automate, but also discover all these different sources? So for example, the SQL databases, the Azure SQL databases, Terraform, SAP, name it, or all the different SaaS applications. How can we automate that? And how can we classify that data, what's coming out of there, and how can we specify the sensitivity of the data? And for example, what is also very important, where is the data coming from? So what will be my data lineage? The third pillar is, how can I maximize my business value of data for my data consumers? You will see that there are getting more and more people in the organization which are using data, but also different roles. And all these different roles, like a data scientist, a data engineer, a data analyst, they want to use the data from a trusted catalog. So if you're talking about customers, we are talking about customers and not customer A, customer B, or customer C. We have one definition of what is for us a customer. And they want to search that quickly. How can I search quickly to the definition of my table definitions? And what I already explained, how can we get that bird view about our Azure Purview? So how can I visualize everything in some reports about my scans, about my glossary, and about my assets? Within Azure Purview, we have a couple of different features. If you go back to the previous slides, I explained to you we have a data map. The Azure Purview, the base of the Azure Purview platform, is a data map, where we can define all these different scanning and classifications of the multi-cloud SaaS application, of the multi-cloud our SaaS applications, and different on-prem data. There are about 20 plus out-of-the-box connectors and file formats supported. And if you look to all the data sources, we have Power BI, SQL Server on-prem, all the different Azure data services, including Synapse, Cosmos, and storage, and some non-Microsoft systems, which are coming up like SAP, SAP for HANA, and Teradata, but also Amazon S3. On top of that data map, you will also get the C0 platform, or the C0 data catalog for free. With that data catalog, you can start searching, browsing, and all your asset details, and you can automate the metadata and the lineage extraction. And we have some options available in the management center, and later on, you can also define the private endpoints. A little bit more is the C1, And now you will see that we also can do the Linux visualizations and workflows. So if you want to have a full Linux control visualized, then you need at minimum the C1 tier. And then you have to build built-in integrations with your solutions to automatically extract all this Linux from your data factory and from your Azure Data Share. And the C0 and the C1 are more for the data producers and the consumers. The last one is more the insight one, and that's more for data officers and security officers. And that's D1, where we all have all the insights and also, of course, the sensitive information types and labelings insights with Microsoft 365 Compliance Center. Within Azure PureView, we can define a couple of roles. I know I'm talking a lot, but later on, I will do a lot of demos as well to show you how the product will work. But yeah, sometimes to do some introduction of a product, there's a lot of to talk about as well. So the first role, we have a data source administrator. That's if you have defined or assigned that role, you cannot access the PureView portal, but you can do some aspects of the scanning. And this is an ideal role for programmatic processes, such as server principles. So I can create a service principle which can do through an API call my scanning. And okay, that service principle doesn't need to have access to the portal. And it can also automatically register new data sources through the REST API. And if you try to connect, if that role is assigned to you and you try to connect to the PureView portal, you will get the following error message. The second role is the data source or the Azure PureView data reader. That person can read the PureView portal or has access. It can read all the content in the Azure PureView environment. It has its own homepage, and it has some meta or management information tabs, which you can see on the left side. And the last one is a data curator. That's the one I like a god mode. He can do all the assets or edit the assets, classifications and glossary terms. It can also apply, he can also apply the different classifications and the glossary terms to the assets. But if you have only assigned the data curator role, you cannot register data sources. You can only read them. And if you try to register a data source, you will get, of course, an error message as well that you are not authorized to access that account. This role has its own homepage because the option with a register data source or register sources is there as well now. And we have some more management information like the scan rule sets, we can define the integration runtimes, we have some metrics, we can define the credentials with Azure Key Vault, and we can change the name to a more friendly name from of our PureView environment. And if you combine these roles with these different feature types, I've created an overview where you can see what do you need to get in. So if you want to register a source, you need to be a data source admin. And if you want to manage the glossary as well, then you need to be a data curator as well. But what you can see on the fourth line over here. Another very important thing is that pricing. I think a lot of people have seen already a lot of tweets about pricing. What is happening with the pricing? Currently, if you have, you can assign 4 capacity units or 16 capacity units to an Azure PureView data map, and you will see that these 4 capacity units are free until tomorrow. This morning, yes, this morning came out that this free capacity will be released until the 31st of May. So it will be extended for 3 more months. So you have still 3 more months to try out Azure PureView for free. What will, and very important, that you have to be a CSP subscription. There are some subscription types which are eligible for this free tiers. You can find that on the Azure PureView pricing page, or you can visit my website where I've explained everything. If you are charged for Azure PureView, you will see that it will be around 25 or 26 euros a day. So that's about €750 a month. But if you compare it to other data governance products, this is really, really cheap. A normal product will cost you about €25,000 a year. And if you do this, it will only cost you about around €10,000 to €12,000 a year. The metadata storage is currently still in free in preview. Then we have the scanning and classification. Power BI is free, SQL Server on-premise free, and the other data sources. The scanning is free in preview, but it will be there are 16 fee core hours for free every month until also the end of May. So you can try the scanning as well a bit, so that it doesn't cost you that much. So currently, I think my Azure preview is cost me around 20 or 30 euros a month. So that's doable. And the last one is the Azure Preview Data Catalog, where you can see the Z0, the C1, and the D0. The C0 will always be for free because that's included in the Azure Data Preview Data Map. And the C1 and the D0 are currently in the still free in the preview. And pricings are the new pricing are will be available by the end of May. Do you want to know more about these pricing? Please follow the link below. So now we have done a lot of the theoretical stuff. We will go to the Azure Preview Studio. If you open the Azure Preview Studio, you will see that it has a similar look like the Synapse Analytics Studio. On top of the screen, we have a couple of buttons. So we have the update button. We can switch accounts. So if you have more Preview accounts assigned to your named account, you can switch with this button to these different Azure Preview accounts, the notifications, and of course some feedback. And leaving feedback about the product is highly appreciated by the product teams. On the main screen, we have the metrics where you can see how many data sources are connected to the platform, how many assets are scanned, and how many glossary terms are defined. Then we have the search button where we can search our catalog. We have the recently identities and where you can see, okay, these are the identities accessed within this account. And you have also the option to see what are my own items. And then we have the key activities, and these key activities will change based on your role you have. So the reader role has different activities than the curator role. And of course, there are some useful links to get to directly to the documentation and to the Yammer file and to the tech community. Like in Azure Synapse, we have also the activity hubs. The home, I'll just explain to you where all the quick actions are. Then we have the sources where we can create the collections, where we can register the data sources, and where we can set up the different scans. Of course, we can define the glossary, where we can import, export terms by using a CSV, but where you also can manage your term templates and your custom attributes, insights, the insights of your data, the reports, and a management center where we can do all the metadata management classifications. The resource sets, we can create the integration runtime over there, and that integration runtime is the same as you are you're used to set up for in your Synapse Analytics or in your data factory. You can define some alerts, and you can add some security things over there, and also you can create your Azure Data Factory and your data share connections. So let's switch my screen. And to show you a little bit about the Azure Preview portal. Two seconds. So if you want to create a new Preview account, you can click on the Preview accounts and you can click on create. Of course, like all the other Azure services, you have to define a resource group of your desired thing. And you have to define a name for that. If you click on the configuration tab, you will see the difference between the 4 capacity and the 16 capacity units. So the 4 capacity units are free until the end of May. And then by default, they are currently still enabled because the products, the catalog and the data insights are free during this public preview. If you have created that account, we can click on the PureView account, and you will see that I am a curator, I will have the option to open a PureView Studio. I can manage users, and I can do the documentation. So like in Azure Synapse, you can define the users over there with different roles. In Azure PureView, it's all through the access control, where you have these different roles about Azure PureView. So if you add a new role assignment over here, you will search for PureView. You will see that there are three roles available, which you can assign to your users. So if I open the PureView Studio, I have to log in. And you will see directly the home page where with the metrics over here and with the different key activities and also the documentation. If you go to the left side, we have the different activity hubs where we can do the sources. I will explain in my next session what we can do over there. We have the option to see with all the collections, but you can also only see it as a table view over here. We can do the glossary over here, where we can create new terms, but we can also import terms, and then based on the term you have already created, or you just create a new term template. Of course, the reports, and the last one is the management center. In the management center, we can change the name to a more friendly name. We can define different scan rule sets, but very important as well, we can set up an integration runtime, self-hosted, so it should be running for your SQL Server on-prem. The metrics are in the Azure Monitor. We have the classification rules over here. I'm getting back there a little bit later as well. But very important, we can create, connect our data factory instances over here, but also our data share. If you want to connect a new data factory instance, you just click on new, you can select your subscription, you can choose between which data factory you want to connect. And if you see they are grayed out, if they're grayed out, that means they are connected currently to this PureView account, but then they're already connected to another PureView account. And of course, you can also connect your data share, and that's the same situation. Just select your subscription and select the data share you want to connect to. Then we have some access control, what I already explained to you, which is in the IAM, and we have the credentials. Within the credentials, you can set up your key vault, so a connection to your key vault, and then you can use credentials over here, which you are going to need if you want to set up a scan. So then you don't have to store any credentials within the PureView, but you can store all your credentials within your Azure Key Vault. And that's the preferable way. So going back to the slides. So I explained, okay, and then we still have here the notifications, which is very easy to see what kind of new functionalities the product team has released. You can switch the account over here and the notifications and the feedback you can leave on the system. Switching back. So if you now look what I just explained, we have the PureView data map. So in the left bottom, you will see in which position I'm talking, and we will go slowly back to the top. The PureView data map unify and make data meaningful. Here is the do you have the possibility to automate your metadata scanning and the lineage identification with the hybrid data sources. we have the you have the 100 and plus built-in custom classifiers, but I just showed you over here in the screen. These classifications are in there by default. Yes, you can create your own custom classifications, but they are in there by default. Like for Europe, we have the GPS coordinates, we have mobile phone numbers, we have the identification numbers, we have passport numbers. And if you want to have one for Italy or for the Netherlands, you can define them by yourself. And you can also assign the Microsoft Information Protection tab sensitivity labels. If you want to assign the Microsoft Information Protection sensitivity label, you have to define the scope. To define, if you create a new label, you have to define the scope, and then you have to enable the Azure PureView Assets option over here. To define a new a source, you can click on the register, and you will see that there are currently these sources are available. And hopefully next week during Ignite, they will announce a little bit more new resources. What I already explained to you a little bit or mentioned about the SAP, the Teradata, and the Amazon S3, and hopefully some more other databases as well. Once you have created a new data source, for example, in this case, I have created the data lake. You can create a scan to scan the data what's in your data lake. And if you scan, for example, a data lake, you can also define which containers you wanted to select to be scanned. So that doesn't mean that data in your sandbox is not seen. No, it's not scanned. So it will not work for your lineage as well. Then the second part is the data catalog. You can easily search for data over there. So every different roles, a data scientist, a data engineer, or a data analyst can just in type customer, and you will see on your screen what kind of different suggestions are there for your assets. Talking about assets, if you want to directly scan or see what kind of assets we have, you just click on the button assets. For example, I want to see, okay, what kind of SQL servers do I have in my system? I can click on the SQL server button, and after that you will see the different SQL servers with all the different databases or data stores connected to these servers. And if you select one database, you will see, okay, in this case, I have the Babylon SQL logical server, the database WildWorld importers, and different schemas which are resides in the database. And then I will see directly all the different Azure SQL tables as well. And then, of course, once we have done all these scans, we can have our lineage control. And as you can see over here, my data is coming from my data lake. It's, or from my, in this case, from this side, from the view cities from my data store, it's copied. It's copied to the data lake as a stage item, and then it is copied to the SQL table at the end. And if you go to the Power BI, you will see I have a Power BI report over here with Wide World Importers, which is connected to the Wide World data sets, and that one is connected to the database. So what is missing? I want to know, I have a report in Power BI, and from which sources in my system is the data coming from? The missing pin is still between the database and the SQL table over there. But I'm sure that will come. If you look to this next screenshot, you will see that I've in one overview the data from all my from the dashboard to the Power BI report back to the blob storage or even a Twitter database. But that's coming in the near future. So now we have handled the data map, the data catalog, and the last one is the data insights, where we can where we have reports on assets, on scans, on glossary, classifications, and labeling. Yeah, I can go in detail over here, but it's better to show you later on in the demo what you can see over there. And yeah, what do we have more? What's currently in preview? We have a marriage between Synapse and PureView. And within Synapse, I can create a connection to PureView and I can directly integrate these data over there and search for data definitions. And when I heard this, I know there are a lot of people went to the PaaS summits in Seattle. And in 2015, during the keynote from the PaaS summit, Michael's new vision immediately became clear. We have became clear with walk with your head in the cloud and your feet on the ground. I just don't know why this came up, but it looks like, okay, hey, we have Synapse, we have PeerView, and what is Microsoft doing with this to create this together? They want to make a unified experience for their customers. And Azure PeerView will be the heart, or Azure Synapse will be the heart, and there will be different other Azure data services connected to it. So the Azure Data Share, the PeerView, the machine learning, what you already saw in the previous session, and of course Power BI. And then you still have also also the connection with the Cosmos in there as well. To connect within Azure PeerView or in Azure Synapse Analytics, your PeerView account, you can just go to the Management tab and then click on the PeerView account, and then you can add your PeerView account to your system. And then once you have done that, you can register new data sources directly from your Synapse Studio within PeerView. You can do the browse and search, and even you can do some enhanced metadata and linters and annotations. And it will make your life easier, much easier. I think last week or 2 weeks ago, they also released the PeerView connection within your Azure Data Factory. So from your Azure Data Factory, you can do the same, what you also can do from your Synapse Analytics. So let's switch screens again. And I will walk you through some other demos about the integration. So I already said or explained to you the different assets. So in Data Factory, I can go to Manage. I can click on my Azure PeerView, and you will see that my PeerView account is connected. And that means that when I am in the pipelines, in the Data Factory pipelines, I can search from here directly in the PeerView catalog. How we can search, I will do a bit later. Within Synapse Analytics, we have the same option over here. So if you go from the Home tab, going to the Management tab, to the PeerView tab, you will see that you can connect to a PeerView account. So if I click on that button, you have to select from your own subscription, or if you do it manually, you can also connect to a PeerView account in a different subscription. You click on Apply, and once you have clicked on Apply, the integration will start in the background. It will take a couple of seconds, and once that's done, you can directly connect from your PeerView or from your Synapse site to your PeerView account. So you will see it over here. You can click on it, and you will see that my PeerView account will directly open. Going back to the PeerView. So, Home, what are we going to do? We're going to add a new, we're going to register a new data source. As you can see, this is the table view, but we also have the map view. And you see that I have already created a new collection for my Cosmos. So I'm going to add a new Cosmos database over here. Oh, sorry. Register a new data source. You don't going to believe it. I just explained to you, Oracle is coming. SAP HANA is coming. I was preparing my demos yesterday. These sources weren't in there. So as you can see, a lot of new sources came in last night. Cool to see if you do a live demo. I'm going to connect to my Cosmos DB over here. Connect. I'm going to select from which subscription I want to have it. I'm changing the name. I always use the same naming convention which I'm using for my Synapse and my Databricks. So link service, Cosmos DB, and then the account, and you will see that this is my account, and I can click on register, and directly you will see that it will be added to my collection of Cosmos. I'm using it in this situation based on my different types of sources, but you can also set it up with different data centers. So I have my data center in the North Europe, I have a data center in Germany, and I have a data center in West Europe, for example, where all different sources live. And I want to see what is in which data center belongs. So once you have done that, you can start scanning your data. So I'm just going to click on the data lake. I click on view details, and you can see that I can set up a scan. I have set up a scan for every week. I can click on a new scan. I can call it a name, week two, for example. The credential I want to use, in this case, I have did the managed identity credential to the preview MSI, but you can also choose for an account key if you want to have that. I will explain it in a bit how you can do that. Continue. Then it will test the connection, and then you can see that I can define my own folder or containers within my data lake, which I want to scan. If you do it for a SQL database, then if you have more databases connected to your logical server, you can choose which data source or database you want to scan. You can click on continue. You have a rule set. Currently, I'm still using the default rule the scan sets. And then you can say, okay, I want to scan it every month. I want to have it weekly based on weeks. I want to do it every week, or I'm just creating it at once. If you do it once, the advantage later on is that you, like here, I can say, okay, run scan now. I'm just scanning whenever I do a demo, I do scan my data. So I can click on incremental scan, then it will only look for the new increments which are in my system, or I can click on full scan, and then it will do a complete search, of course, of the whole thing. For example, if you edit your scan and you're changing the options over here with so at March, for example, then you need to do a full scan, and that the system knows that there are no new containers to that added to the scan. Going back, so I explained to you how to you can create a run or a scan. I explained to you how you can create a new schedule, and then we have also the scan rule sets. And a scan rule set is actually something. Yeah, you can create a new rule set based on a source type, for example, the blob storage. You say test. You can define a description, and then you can click on continue. And you can create, okay, this is, you have to select which kind of file types, and you even can create a new custom file type. So if I click on a new file type, and the file type doesn't exist in here, I don't know, maybe, as you can see, gzip, they just released, but maybe you have another file type. You can say new file type. What is the file type? My file type is xxxzzz. The description, is it based on another file? So is it based on a CSV file? Yes, okay, then you can create, and then it will, or you can use a delimiter what's in your file. So for example, if you have fixed white headers, you can define that over here. What can we do more over here? The classifications I just explained to you, you can also create your own custom classification, and then you can say, okay, listen, a new classification, and then you need to add or create a new custom or classification rule as well. Classification rule, custom, I'm just going to show you, edit, and then I can say, okay, I have a custom classification, and I can define the data pattern. In this case, my column pattern is based on person ID. So probably I can find somewhere a custom rule within my data catalog if I have a table with person ID in there. So The next step is that I want to start searching for my assets. For example, I want to search for my few cities, which lives, it looks like it lives only in my data lake. So I can click on that one. It's in my data lake. What kind of data lake? So if I have cities, a table of cities in different data lakes, you will also see different data lakes over here. As you can see over here, it's in my temp folder. Or is it a resource set? A resource set is, for example, if you use a Delta Lake, you will see that you're using a resource set. So there are a lot of files within in the same container. It belongs to each other. Is it a folder or is it a file? If I click on here, you will see that I have some properties over here from the file, the fully class name. And if you have a SQL table, you can also see how many rows are in there. Then you can see the schema. You can see the lineage if there is. And in this case, I have the lineage from my view to it's with the copy activity from my data factory, as you can see over here. I can directly switch to the assets as well. I have the it's stored in the data lake, and then it is copied again. For example, if I select data store, so I want to know what kind of data is in my data store. So I have a data store. I only want to see my SQL databases in which server. So I have my production over here, and I have my development over here. Okay, you see there is some. There are some things with happening in PureView, which is with the capital letters, small letters, which is not working well. But if I click on data store, I can search, for example, for what is it? Oh, let's click. I want to see all the tables where a person name is in there, the classification person name. No, this name, I can click on application people, and you will see that there is a person name defined somewhere as a classification. If there is lineage, you will see it over here. And I can also say, okay, listen, I want to add an expert owner who knows everything about people. So I can click on edit, and I can say, okay, listen, I want to add an expert based on this data. I can add my name or someone else. We'll search. I can say, okay, admin expert. And the next time I directly direct know to which I can ask the question. So even from PureView, you can send directly. You can use the email address, and probably my Outlook will, as you can see, my Outlook will directly open to send an email to that expert owner. So going back to here, I know I have a share, it's called PureView. And I'm just gonna look PureView test. Let's have a look. So I have, PureView test. As you can see, I have an assets in my data share with PureView test. I can click on the InSpark Labs, for example. If I click on that, you will see that I have these tables as an input. I have the status for my snapshots, but very important as well, I have my lineage as you can see over here. And if I look to the lineage, you will see this is my send share. So this is the data I'm sharing. And this is my blob storage with my receive share. I don't know how many people are already used Azure Data Share, but it's a really new, a great new Azure Data Services where you can actually create shares for people where they can pick up their data. And maybe in this case, this is already cataloged data where our business rules are in there, and they can start using it again for as an import for Power BI or something like that. And also here you can again add the expert owners and the rest. Then I'm going to one of the last steps, the reports. I can see all the different scans over here. This one is very easy to see as well. What kind of file types are in my system? So I have a zip file over here. I have TST file, JSON, CSV file, and mostly of my files are Parquet. And that's because one of my containers is used for a data lake. And also, if you look for data lake, you can see that if I do store for every table my data in an original file or a directory, original. Why is it not finding anything? Customer. And now you will see the data over here. And hopefully, no. I was trying to show you something, but I don't know where it is. Okay. Here you will see that this is a resource set. If I click on that one, you will see that my data is stored in the intermediate Delta Lake, and then AdventureWorks, sales, customer, original, and all the different parts. And if you know, if you have Delta Lake, that's all split up in small parts. And this is the way they call it a resource set. But the very important thing in that resource set, you still have the different classifications. What do I want to show you more? Yeah, I want to show you the next thing. Within peer view, we can go. We can search over here. As you can see, we can search for PureView data, but we can also search for workspace data. In this case, I want to search for PureView data. I'm going to look again for customer. And you will see that I see the same things over here. If I look for Power BI, for example, you will see that everything based on Power BI, tickets, the different data sets. And I think there's one I want to show you. There are a lot of them. If you click on that, you will see that there is some lineage, but there is one with peer view test. So I have a dashboard over here in Power BI. As you can see, that dashboard is created from three different reports, from two different data sets which are connected to the data store, and one other data set which is connected to here. And now you will see that you start getting more and more lineage in Power BI. And another great thing, if you go back to that customer, what I just showed you, I can say, okay, this is my customer. I can directly connect to that link service. So that means that from PureView, I can directly create new link services with the storage account already in there if you want to have it on that way. But you can also create a new data integration set, so a new data set, but you can also start developing a new data flow. And it depends on what kind of files you have. You will have other options here as well. This is a resource set. Let me have a check. And also here you can directly say, okay, blah, 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 to do the description. And then it's also saved within your peer view, and you can also overrule some classification. Okay, if you want to say, okay, listen, this has the ABA routing number, and it has that kind of glossary terms, you can save it. And if you go back to then to your sales customers in peer view, you will see that as well. And it's the same situation if you do it with your in your data factory. It's working on the same. And this is the table I just changed. Hopefully you will see there, as you can see, the description there as well, blah, blah, blah. So mostly this is the demo, going back to the presentation. So these are currently all the features which are in public preview. And you will see that the coming weeks, more and more is coming in. Yeah. The data, the SAP ECC, HANA, Teradata, and the Hive Metastore, they were coming. But as you can, which I just showed you, they're in there. Hopefully the connections with Synapse and Databricks are coming as well. And that's the same we're expecting for the data lineage, for notebook support and Delta Lake support. And if you want to create your own data lineage, you still can use the Atlas API, where you can define your custom lineage and just search in Google up Atlas API Pureview, and you will see enough information. Go looking back to the roadmap. Already said data quality, data privacy, master data management. And the final role, the work will be that we have PureView on top of all our sources within our company, and that will be our data governance opportunity. So if you have some questions left, please do ask them in the chat, and otherwise you can send me questions on Twitter or LinkedIn, and the slides will be available on my blog.